What is encapsulation?
Oh, everybody knows that.
Let the caller depend on the contract, keep the data and behavior on those data unknown to the caller. That was easy. But you should know that there is more into it. While it is easy to say what encapsulation is, doing it right in complex domain modeling can be tricky. In this video, I will show you the hard part of it. You will learn a technique for preserving class invariants, and surprise, surprise, that will be encapsulation. If you want to learn how that works, stay with me and watch the demo I have prepared. This is the demo application modeling the bookstore, and this is the book model. These two fields, identity and the title, are populated from the database. And so is the collection listing the authors, but it is internal. It is not meant to be used by the consumers of this model. For public use, we have this sequence, so everybody should use this sequence publicly and display the authors or navigate or do whatever they do with book authors. And here's the model of the book author. It is modeling many-to-many relationship, which is common in domain modeling. One book can have multiple authors, and one author can have multiple distinct books, so it is clearly a many-to-many relationship. This property should be used to sort the authors before displaying the book. I made it mutable. By intention, you will see that that will cause a lot of troubles later. Also observe that there is no public constructor. The private one is used by Entity Framework Core to populate the properties. Static factory method guarantees the order of ordinal numbers. They will be unique in sequence 1 to n. There will be no overlapping. There will be no gaps. That is a guarantee. We call that the invariant. Every book will have zero or more authors, and authors will have ordinal numbers from 1 to n. Now, that must be true at any moment during the application's execution. If it is not true, somebody might make a mistake, like printing the authors of the book in the incorrect order. Here in the view, I'm sorting the authors. That is where that ordering becomes important. That's why it must be preserved. But now comes the tricky part. Why sorting in the view? Well, somebody must do the ordering before the data are shown on the screen. Who's gonna do that? The book doesn't say whether it has sorted the authors or not. And this collection above is populated from the database by Entity Framework using the query which does not include order by. Well, now we have problems. But alright, let me run the application, select the Koenig and Ritchie book, and there they go, Koenig, then Ritchie, just as we wanted them to be. The application works fine, but the problem in design remains. Look at the book model. This is what we normally call the anemic domain model. It does nothing. One trait of anemic domain models is that they don't take care of class invariants. They let somebody else think about that. Well, that's not right, really. What if the caller forgot to sort? Most likely everything will be fine, but only due to chance, because the author records will come out from the database in the order in which they were inserted. That is pure luck. That is not intended. And if we change the ordinal numbers later, then the order coming from the database would effectively be incorrect. We must ensure that that feature works fine every time. But that's not all. Worse yet, the contained objects are mutable. The book author object is owned by the book object, but not controlled by it. Look, I can go to the consumer and isolate the last author. Maybe the book doesn't even have the author, so I have to check for null. But if it exists, I can change its ordinal number to an insane value that doesn't make sense. The book author object might allow ordinal zero, but book's contract is that authors have ordinals from 1 to n. 0 is not a valid inside the book, even though it could be valid inside the book author object alone. The problem with this faulty code is that I have just modified the object that belongs to the book without telling the book that that happened. I will run the application, pick the Kernighan Ritchie book, and guess what? It becomes the Ritchie Kernighan book. Nonsense. And the book doesn't know that. That is the primary problem. I have breached encapsulation. By this point, you have seen the code that does not work well. And it doesn't work well because the class that is responsible for invariants doesn't check them, doesn't guarantee that they will hold. In the remainder of this demo, you will see me fix this design issue and you will see how I will apply encapsulation right. But before that, I have a personal note to you. Visit me on Patreon and join the sponsors who are already helping this channel remain free. That will let you download the source code of this video and all other videos in this playlist, but also give you access to some goodies that will not be visible on the YouTube channel. And also, you can always press the like button if you like the content you're watching. Let's get on to fixing the problems in this class's design. As I have pointed out, the problem is that the owner doesn't know that the objects it owns are changing. And the invariant spans multiple objects. It's not legal to change just one contained object, but that change might cause other objects to change as well so that the invariant is preserved. On the one hand, the book class is encapsulating the collection properly. Nobody can just add or remove things from that collection without the book knowing that. That is the good part. I want that same level of encapsulation also applied to individual objects inside the collection. So let me encapsulate the invariants then. The model will not expose book author objects. That is too much information for the caller. The caller wants to know who are the authors of the book, not how they are being sorted. So the model will only expose persons, that is the part of that book author object. The model, this class, will be responsible for sorting before returning the authors. That will have the immediate effect on the consumer in several ways. One, the confusion about who will be responsible to sort, should we sort it here or not, is now gone. And it's gone in a very peculiar way. The consumer doesn't even have the access to the ordinal property. So even if it wanted to sort the objects, it doesn't know how to do that. So I'm deleting that. Also, there's no this indirection anymore. The code becomes a tad shorter. But here is the more important part. The bug I made above becomes impossible. I cannot violate the book object's invariant. It wouldn't let me. So all I can do is to just delete this portion of code. That puts all the power on the model itself, the well-encapsulated model. Here's the example. Maybe we don't want to sort the same set of items many times over. And we decide to change the design of this class so that it guarantees that the items are only sorted once. Here is the idea. First, force entity framework core to populate the list. But we don't know when the list will be populated, but we do know that it will be populated before anyone can access the author's property getter. So I'll show you a coding trick that works every time. So I will set the lazy list which will be sorted. Look here. I will set it up in the constructor. prepare a local function that ensures the list is sorted, sort the outers using comparison of ordinal numbers, just as the invariant defines that, and then return that list. So that list will definitely be sorted at the time when the lazy object captures it. Now create the lazy list with this function as the factory and everything is done. And now comes the funny part. By the time anyone can access the outers getter, the entity framework will already have the outers collection populated, and then the outers property getter will trigger the lazy object and it will execute the factory function once. Every next access to the outers property will just return the same reference to the list, and that will be that list from the collection above outers collection. Therefore, we can remove the sorting in every call. The feature is implemented. It is preserving the invariant the same way as it did before. Nobody outside can see that I did anything here. If it turns out that this was not a bright idea, we can always revert it, and again, nobody will know that we did that. That is encapsulation. But there is more about that invariant and encapsulation. What if we really wanted to swap the order of outers of the book? Maybe somebody entered the data incorrectly and they want to correct the error. Well, this time, changing the order of outers is the book class's responsibility. So I must expose a public method which does that. Take the index into the list. The decision to use the list is encapsulated, only I know that it is the list under the hood, so let me take that list as well. This is the reference to the sorted list. Now validate the input. That gives me the idea that the move might not be possible in every case. So let me return Boolean and change the name of this method to try move outer up. Now, I'm telling the caller that this request might not be possible. So, let the caller cope with the results. But if the call is impossible, the method will not make any changes to the underlying objects and it will not violate the invariant. After validation, we can start doing things right. Swap the two objects in the list. But then comes the important part, preserving the invariant. Update ordinal value in both objects, so that again, if ordinal numbers were forming the sequence of 1 through n, they will still form that sequence 1 through n again after this operation, on top of the list remaining sorted by the ordinal number. Invariant preserved to the letter. I really like this. And then, what if we really wanted to make that swap again at the calling end? Nothing special, just let the book do that for us. I could even check if this method returned true or false and do whatever I planned to do on failure, for example. I have no objections right now, this is the best try. So let me run the application one more time. The Kernighan-Ritchie book, here it is. When I get into the details, it becomes the Ritchie-Kernighan book. Odd, but it works fine. The difference this time is that the book's invariants have been preserved. If we wanted to do anything with the book on this page, that should work just fine, because the book object is still perfectly valid thanks to the encapsulation. If you look at the operation, there's quite a lot of code there. All this code is meant to preserve the invariant and to encapsulate the state and operations on that state inside this domain model. That is what makes it a rich domain model, as opposed to the anemic one, which we don't want to have. So I hope that you have learned something valuable about encapsulation and class invariants from this video. Don't forget to support me at Patreon again, to like this video, to subscribe to my channel, and see you in the next episode.